Morphisms, I have a space of morphisms here, and I should associate a morphism in something with a discrete topology. If all the morphism spaces are locally path connected, then a continuous map from a space into a discrete thing is just the same as a map of sets from pi zero of that set into into the other set. So this is true if all Cx comma y are locally path connected. Just because taking pi zero in that case is left adjoint to giving the discrete topology. Okay, so morally, this thing is like left adjoint to that functor, except it's not actually true. So that's that construction. Now, if I take if I take H of C D B, that's an ordinary category. There's an obvious functor to the category I talked about yesterday. An object here is an embedded submanifold. Just forget that it's embedded and take the induced smooth structure. That's an abstract manifold. So with the smooth structure. If I have a morphism here, I can take, because of this condition, it has kind of canonically parameterized colors near the near the ends. And then I could just take the diffeomorphism class as a cobordism with this induced C in and C out and so on. And that diffeomorphism class is does not change if I if I have a path in this space. So path in this space then becomes an embedded bundle over an interval, and then the two endpoints are going to be diffeomorphic. So if I write pi zero here, this would be the kind of isotopy class, or the class in pi zero, and the diffeomorphism class is then well defined. And this preserves composition, so this is a functor. So that's how these are related. And I claim that if the dimension of V is big compared to D, then this is an equivalence of categories. And in particular, that's going to be true if you take that colimit over bigger and bigger V. How am I doing on time? Good. claim HCDV to cob D. Is an equivalent.
Can I ask about this colimit?
Yep.
I'm always confused about whether or not that thing is actually contractible or if it's a weak
homotopy. Oh, let me just claim that it's weakly contractible. Yeah, that's maybe a better claim to make. And this means weak equivalence. If there's any doubt, it's better to just say weakly contractible, because that's all you ever need, instead of worrying about if it's one or the other. So let's do that. okay, why is this an equivalence of categories? Or maybe I should also have said, regarding this question of identities, not that I want to dwell on that. A non-unital category having identities, the way you usually write it, it looks like extra structure, but really it's a property because of this easy exercise that identities are unique if they exist. And if I take H CDV, then that does have identities, like composing with a cylinder. If I take pi zero of the morphism spaces, I can like deform back to where I started in some way that I'll not write down. So this is unital, just as a comment. Why is this an equivalence of categories? Well, why is it essentially surjective? Oh, this is if the dimension of V is big compared to D. Essentially surjective means anything is isomorphic to something from there. So given some abstract closed D minus one manifold, why is it the underlying smooth manifold of some sub-manifold of some Euclidean space? Well, that's precisely what witness embedding theorem tells you. If the dimension of V is at least twice this number, then there exists an embedding into V, then just take the image of that. It's going to be diffeomorphic. Choose M. I can embed it into R twice this, 2D minus 2. And then dimension of V just means to need to be big enough that there's a linear embedding of this into V. So it's essentially surjective if dimension of V is bigger than or equal to 2D minus 2 by Whitney embedding. Then we have to check fully faithful. Why is it full? That means surjective on Thom sets. That's very similar. If I have two embedded things and I have an abstract cobordism between them, why is that the underlying thing of an embedded cobordism? Well, you need to embed that abstract thing into V cross an interval. And sort of extending the given embedding of the endpoints, and a version of the Whitney embedding theorem also tells you that. So full is the same argument. Maybe you need 2D because you're trying to, or maybe in even 2D plus 1, you're trying to embed manifold of dimension D. Faithful has to do with the embedding spaces being connected. So if you have two abstract, if you have two embedded things that are diffeomorphic real endpoints, why can I realize that diffeomorphism by an isotopy? And a fancy version of the Whitney embedding theorem also tells you that the embedding space is connected, provided provided the dimension of V is high enough. So probably something like 2D plus 2 or something. embedding of an abstract cobordism between two embedded things is unique up to isotopy. If you pick two embeddings, there's a path of embeddings between them. and that's that means if you take pi zero of the morphism spaces there, you precisely get the morphism sets there. Okay, that's the relationship, and that's the sense in which in which I've sort of lifted this thing. So under this construction, it goes to a category that's equivalent to cob D, provided dimension of V is big enough, or take the collimate. Okay, that was a long discussion about that. Now, okay, and these spaces are locally path connected, so there is a so if I take H C and then take iota, so I have the same objects. And then a locally path-connected space has a continuous map to its own pi zero. Just send a point to its path component. This is given the discrete topology. So I can regard that as a functor from there to there. Now this thing here is of course surjective, and if I regard it as a continuous map, it is one connected. So one connected means bijection on pi zero, surjection on pi one, but pi one there is trivial, so that's of course true. And it's set up to be a bijection on pi zero. So that means, okay, where am I going? This was a little bit out of order. Let me get back to that for a moment. I want to take classifying space of a topologically enriched category. And I just do it the same way. Take the nerve. Now take the space of, I mean take the same underlying set as before. NP of C means composable P tuples of morphisms. And now I've topologized morphisms, so just give this the product topology. Then the nerve is a simplicial space. And I just define the classifying space as before, as the geometric realization of the nerve, which means the disjoint union of NP of C cross delta P. Where I just use the topology here and give this the product topology. And this the quotient topology. So it's simplicial if this is a category. If it's only non-unital, then this is a semi-simplicial space. So that's what I should have said. Semi-simplicial means I don't have degeneracies, and then I should not quotient out by the thing that involves degeneracies. So let's do that. Sometimes called the thick realization. Good. So, okay, where I'm going is I have this canonical map here. I want to take B of that and ask how connected is it. Turns out it's always two connected, no matter what topological enriched category you start with. And that's what I was just starting to explain there. And zero C is just the set of objects maps to N zero H C, which is also the set of objects. So this is a bijection. And one C is the total space of morphisms. So in other words, the disjoint union X Y, C X Y. And one HC, given the discrete topology, is just pi zero of this space. But mapping a space to its own pi zero is always one connected. Same argument applies to N2. So this is also one connected and therefore zero connected. So in general, for all P, the induced map of NP is 2 minus P connected. And then there's a general fact about semi-simplacial topological spaces, that if you have a map of such things, where the map of P simplices is, well, K minus P connected, then the map of realizations is K connected. NP of C to NP of HC. This is always 2 minus P connected for all P. And this implies that NC to NHC is 2 connected. Well, that's great, because at the end of last lecture, we were looking for a space with a 2 connected map into B of cop D. And and then we can just use this embedded cobordism category. So if dimension of V is big, CD V to iota H CD V. Well, then this was equivalent to iota cob D induces 2 connected map from B C D V to B cob D. So this thing I called X at the beginning of the lecture and last time, I can use this one. So it induces an equivalence from the fundamental groupoid. So for classifying field theories, we can use this space instead. So maybe the first time you see this, it looks like that was a step in the wrong direction. I had just an ordinary plane category, and now I have to talk about topologically enriched and so on. But that's until you know better. What turns out for this space, you can just write a formula for its homotopy type in terms of something that looks simple. Where I don't know a good formula for the homotopy type of this thing. So this is a version of a theorem I proved with Yves Madsen, Ulrike Tillmann, and Michael Weiss. That's a formula for not only the fundamental groupoid, but the whole homotopy type. So, okay, before I can write the answer, I have to tell you. Just one or two things. So, that's the Grassmannian of D planes and V. What should I call that? No, X something. D-dimensional linear subspaces. So the usual Grassmannian of D planes and V. the usual topology. Over that, there's a vector bundle called the universal vector bundle. And there's its orthogonal complement. It's just the space of pairs of x, comma v in the Grassmannian cross v itself. So that little v is in the orthogonal complement of the space. So this is a vector bundle whose fiber dimension is dimension of v minus d. And then Td, comma v is the Thom space, this bundle. So that means the one-point compactification. Of the total space, or up to homeomorphism, you can also take the disk bundle and take the quotient by the sphere bundle. So this is a space, finite dimensional CW complex. Then you take that for R plus V. The R has to do with the morphism directions. And then you take the V-fold loop space. So this means the space of pointed maps from SV to TD, R plus V, where SV means the one-point compactification of V. So if V is Rn, then this is just Sn, and this is the n-fold loop space. V is Rn, R plus V becomes Rn plus 1, and this becomes the n-fold loop space. So that's what the theorem is about the homotopy type. In terms of things that are kind of familiar in homotopy theory, in the original paper we proved this in the direct limit, where this co-limit over bigger and bigger V, but it's also true for finite dimensional V.
All finite dimensional V,
yeah. Even like if the dimension is equal to d. Let's see, is that true? Yes. So you always have the empty set here. So if d is bigger than v, both sides are a point. Yeah, no conditions. And there's also a version with orientation and any tangential structure you like. Let me not write that down, but in the last few minutes, let me just explain what that says about pi 1. Okay, so in a special case, okay, just to repeat what I said before, there's, as far as I know, no good formula for the homotopy type of this thing. So this is maybe evidence that this topologically enriched thing is a more natural object. Let me spend 2 or 3 minutes on the case d equals 1 and v equals r, where I drew this picture before. Maybe let me make the picture a little bit more complicated. Here's a morphism from 5-element set to a 3-element set. In that case, Grassmann 1 of R plus V is Grassmann 1 of R2. The space of one unoriented one planes in R2, also known as RP1, I mean, also known as a circle, but let me write it this way. This vector bundle over a circle, if you think about it a little bit, this will be the Möbius band. The non-trivial one-dimensional vector bundle over a circle. If you one-point compactify the Möbius band, you get RP2. Then you take loops of RP2, and you take the fundamental groupoid. Well, the fundamental groupoid has to do with pi 0 and pi 1. So pi 0 of loops of RP2, that's pi 1 of RP2, which is z mod 2. Whereas pi 1, the fundamental group, loops of RP2, some base point, pi 2 of RP2 is pi 2 of S2, which is Z. So that tells you that the fundamental groupoid of loops of RP2, up to equivalence, it has just two objects. I mean, it has two isomorphism classes, but if I pick one of each, the isomorphism group is going to be Z. So up to equivalence, this is going to be, I think people sometimes call it, okay, I'm going to write Z disjoint union Z, but this means the one object groupoid with automorphism group Z, disjoint union itself. So that's determining the universal functor from this groupoid, this group category, into a groupoid, and it will be this groupoid. Okay, let me end there.